Census. On 25th November 2015, we celebrated the centenary of this remarkable theory. In Einstein's view, gravitation is synonymous with space-time geometry and mathematically described by the curvature or distortion of space-time. Gravity is described by Einstein's equations, which you see on the cartoon below. It basically is a system of 10 nonlinear partial differential equations. And as the equation shows you, matter tells space-time how to curve. In turn, space-time tells matter how to move. Just 3 days after he came up with the general theory of relativity, Einstein wrote to the famous physicist Sommerfeld, "During the last month, I experienced one of the most exciting and most exacting times of my life. True enough, also one of the most successful. Now, the marvelous thing which I experienced was the fact that not only did Newton's theory result as the first approximation, but also the perihelion of Mercury, 43 seconds of arc per century, as the second approximation." What was he talking about? If you look at the orbit of Mercury, it is not a closed ellipse because we are not dealing with a simple two-body problem, but a body perturbed by other planets. The astronomer Verrier, who predicted and discovered the planet Neptune, studied the motion of Mercury for a long time, for about 15 years, and came to the conclusion that, as expected, the orbit was not an ellipse fixed in space, but precessing by 574 seconds of arc per century, a very small amount. But the point was that this was not fully accountable. If you took together the perturbations due to the planets, it added up to 531 seconds of arc. So there was 43 seconds of arc missing. And what Einstein is telling Sommerfeld is that his theory, which corrects Newton's theory, predicted this 43 seconds of arc exactly. This was an important prediction because if you looked at the earlier version of his theory, which was given in 1912, it predicted only 18 seconds of arc per century. So this was an interesting test of the theory of gravity, which he was trying to construct. If you look at this analysis, one realizes that one is dealing here with the two-body problem in general theory of relativity, but in what we call as the test particle limit, because the effect of Mercury on the gravitational field is not taken into account because it is a test particle in the orbit, in orbiting around the sun. Any relativistic theory of gravitation like general relativity must be consistent with the principle of special relativity. So the effect of gravity cannot be transmitted faster than light. If the gravitational field of an object changes, these changes propagate through space and take a finite time to reach other objects. Hence, there is the possibility of gravitational waves from Einstein's equations, just as we have the more familiar electromagnetic waves from Maxwell's equations. So gravitational waves are freely propagating oscillations of the gravitational field. Uniform gravitational fields can be transformed away. That's the equivalence principle. So physically, gravity manifests as a tidal effect. So one can say gravitational waves are oscillating tidal gravitational fields which propagate out from the source. Gravitational waves were predicted by Einstein in 1916 as an important consequence of his theory using an approximate version of general relativity, which we call linearized gravity. A couple of years later, he gave the famous quadrupole pole formula, which is the analog of the more familiar dipole formula in electromagnetism. It tells us that the gravitational field of a gravitational wave falls off as 1 by r, like any wave, and is given by the second time derivative of the quadrupole moment. If you apply this formula to a system of mass m moving with velocity v at a distance r, the formula simplifies to what is shown here. And if you apply this to a physical system on the Earth, a dumbbell made up of a ton each, separated by a couple of meters, rotating at about a kilohertz, the gravitational wave perturbation is of the order of 10 raised to minus 39. Einstein was not just a great theoretical physicist, he worked in the patent office, and he realized that therefore this must have practically vanishing value in all conceivable situations. Such ripples would be vanishingly small and nearly impossible to detect. And of course, he was right, because the detection of gravitational waves, as you know, took almost 100 years. When one looks at all these predictions which Einstein was trying to make, one realizes that one is trying to solve the problem of motion, not in Newtonian gravity, but in general theory of relativity. And implicitly, one is using what we call today as the post-Newtonian approximation methods. Looking at it more critically, one sees that in this case, one is assuming a weak field expansion, one assuming that the body is moving slowly, and also that one is doing a near zone expansion. That means the retardation effect is much small compared to if you went sort of far away. Even though the test particle motion could be very easily done, if you wanted to apply or obtain the corrections beyond Newtonian gravity for extended bodies, there was a lot of difficulty because of the complications involved in dealing with the internal structures of the bodies in general relativity. And it was only in 1938 that in the work of Einstein, Infeld, and Hofmann, this problem found its first solution and reached the first stage of maturity. The treatment of this is what is normally available in books of Fock, Infeld, and Plibansky, and Landau-Lifshitz. Even though gravitational waves were predicted almost immediately after general relativity was given, there was a lot of confusion, a lot of babble around this particular subject. For example, in 1922, Eddington pointed out that Einstein's derivation did not apply for self-gravitating systems. And if you looked at the full equations, gravitational waves had modes which could propagate at any speed you could imagine. To add to the confusion, in 1936, Einstein wrote to one of his friends, together with a young collaborator, Rosen, I arrived at the interesting result that gravitational waves do not exist. Fortunately, by the time the paper was finally published in another journal, Einstein was convinced of that there was some fault in his interpretation, and this was retracted in the final published version of the paper. The basic question always was, do gravitational waves transfer energy, or are they merely an illusion because of the wavy coordinates we are using? So in this particular period, there were a lot of inconsistent results on the generation of gravitational waves. Instead of progress, you could say that theorists regressed from one point to another. A hard-nosed physicist like Feynman was getting very, very frustrated. In 1957, when he was at one of the GI general relativity meetings, he is supposed to have said, "Drive on, make up your mind, don't be so rigorous or you will not succeed." 4 years later, he was at another general relativity meeting in Warsaw, and he was really frustrated with what was happening, and he wrote to his wife, "A day to discuss, do gravitational waves carry energy? This is not good for my blood pressure." So it was a 40 or 50 years for a conceptual framework to determine without ambiguity if gravitational waves exist in GR and what properties they should have. The technical issues were related to a more clear understanding of whether singularities were coordinate singularities or physical singularities. In a calculation, do you use retarded potentials, advanced potentials, or their combination of them? How do you impose no incoming boundary conditions when you are doing a post-Newtonian calculation? And as usual, whenever you're dealing with a hard problem, it always is advantageous to look away from that particular problem. You look sideways. And the same thing happened in this particular case. Looking sideways away from the confusion led to an insight and to the search for gravitational waves. This happened at the Chapel Hill conference, which I was talking to you about, which happened in 1957. And the main players were Felix Pirani and Hermann Bondy. Pirani argued that even though you are not sure about the generation of gravitational waves, the physical effect of gravitational waves is unambiguously given because it is the tidal effect of the gravitational field and mathematically given by the geodesic deviation equation. In what we call today the sticky bead argument, which is ascribed to Bondi and Feynman, the argument is that if you had a rod and with a couple of beads which fits snugly on it, if a gravitational wave falls on it, the tidal force will make the beads move away from each other and towards each other as the wave propagates. And if there is this friction created, you could even have heat the system, a mechanical system, and therefore you are converting gravitational wave energy to mechanical energy, and therefore it should be a physical effect. Following this particular meeting, Bondi and his other collaborators at King's College came up with a nice mathematical description of gravitational waves by using the Newes function, which is related to the Weyl tensor of the gravitational field. So one can say that at this particular meeting, in a sense, the physicality of gravitational wave was resolved, and it led to the quest for detecting gravitational waves. Because in this particular meeting, there was Joe Weber and John Wheeler. Joe Weber was a remarkable person because he had confidence in the physicality of gravitational waves, and he began gravitational wave detection when, as I told you, the general theory was in disarray in some sense, and instead of being encouraging, was very disabling. He built what we call today as bar detectors, resonant detectors, which are narrow band detectors, and the kind of sources one was looking for were supernovae. In 1966 and 1969, he made claims for gravity wave detection. Unfortunately, this could not be confirmed by other researchers, and therefore, in a sense, we consider him the tragic pioneer of our remarkable field. Even though a global network of bar detectors were built with slightly higher sensitivities, it was another 50 years before the paradigm changed, and bar detectors were replaced by more sensitive laser interferometers. Laser interferometers are broadband detectors, which gives us an advantage, which I will come to in my later slides. And the paradigm shifted from supernovae to coalescing compact binaries. In this story, in the next decade, there was an interesting set of papers by Chandrasekhar, who set up the post-neutronian formalism and attacked the radiation reaction problem. The problem was, how does the emission of gravitational wave affect a self-gravitating system? What is the complexity in this technical calculation? If you consider a self-gravitating body, the gravitational potential is of the same order as V square by the Virial theorem. So if you want to calculate higher order post-Newtonian or higher order V square by C square collections, you cannot deal with linear gravity. You have to face with the non-linearities of Einstein's equations. And therefore, using ingredients which were assembled earlier by Trautmann, Chandra showed that the energy and angular momentum radiated by gravitational waves was correctly balanced by the loss of mechanical energy and angular momentum. This gave astrophysicists confidence that GR was a physically reasonable theory and well-behaved in physical situations. However, mathematical relativists had doubts in his treatment because in the gauge he used, there were divergent terms at 2pn or at V4 by C4 order. Again, as you will see in this particular story, the watershed really came about from some other corner, and that is what I'll come to next. In 1933, Bade and Zucchi predicted that as end states of supernova explosions, neutron stars should exist, should form. These are stars as massive as the sun, but with very, very small radii, so that they are stars at nuclear densities. They are giant nuclei. Jocelyn Bell, who was the graduate student of Tony Hewish, in 1967, while trying to study the scintillation of radio galaxies, discovered objects which had very, very small periods. When one tried to make a model of these particular objects as rotating stars, one could see that their fast speed, the small periods essentially meant that they could not be ordinary stars or even white dwarfs. they had to be rotating neutron stars. So in a sense, we have found clocks in the heavens, celestial clocks, the roamers of the heavens. And the discovery of these celestial clocks would have impact astrophysics. And this was sort of realized, because of which in 1974, a Nobel Prize was awarded to Ryle and Hewish. Unfortunately, Jocelyn Bell, who deserved to be on that prize, was not included. But it's interesting that in 2018, the Breakthrough Prize for the Discovery of Pulsars was awarded to Jocelyn Bell. Once pulsars were discovered, other astronomers started looking for more pulsars. And in 1974, Hulse, again, who was a graduate student of Taylor, while making a survey, discovered a pulsar which seemed to behave in a more complex way than before. It was not showing the periodicity which you sort of expected. And therefore, it was sort of a model that really one had seen, what one was seeing in the observation was the reflection of a system in a binary system, a system which had an orbital period of about 8 hours. And by using techniques from radio astronomy, which we call pulsar timing, you could reconstruct this particular object, the orbit of this particular object. And since this object has a varying quadrupole moment, if general relativity is right, this system must emit gravitational waves, spiral inwards, rather than move in a fixed elliptical orbit. And indeed, in a few years, Weisberg and Taylor could verify this, and observations of this particular object over 30 years essentially has shown that it satisfies the quadrupole formula. Now, the question turned the other way around. There was a controversy that the quadrupole formula, which Einstein derived by using the linearized formula, how can it work for an object which is strongly gravitating? The discovery of this object was remarkable, and therefore, again, in 1993, Hulse and Taylor got the Nobel Prize for the discovery of an object which allowed you to test gravity more than before. Many other pulsars have now been discovered, which have even shorter orbital periods. That means they are moving even faster than the Hulse-Taylor pulsar. The fact that you could test post-Newtonian theory against a physical system revived more critical questions regarding the existing treatment of gravitational waves. It forced all the researchers to revisit approximation methods in general relativity so that you could remedy the mathematical shortcomings of the existing treatments and get to what I call today as the Mach II approximation methods. And in an important meeting in Les Hoosh in 1982 on gravitational radiation, the discussion really went around why one is seeing, you know, whatever one is seeing here. And one of the insights which really came was from Thibaut Damour, who basically said that the reason the quadrupole formula works for the binary neutron star is because of the fact that in the general theory of relativity, there is an effacing principle. And what happens due to that is that in the equations of motion, the reflection of the internal structure happens at higher orders and not at the leading order. And therefore, the next set of things was our question that, can we improve upon the quadrupole prediction of Einstein by calculating the higher order correction, the post-Newtonian generation of gravitational waves? Can you compute the higher order gravitational radiation losses in binary systems to see if they could also be seen in the binary pulsar data? This essentially was the motivation for the thesis of Luc Blanchet of his two theses with Thibaut Damour, and they set up what we call today as the multipolar post-Minkowskian formalism, which I'll explain a little later. A little in parallel, something else was sort of happening. The story for the search for gravitational waves, the LIGO story, which again begins with Ray Wise, who wrote a paper which was called the Electromagnetically Coupled Broadband Gravitational Antenna. It's interesting that he tried to write this paper when he was teaching a course on general relativity. And he says that he was influenced by the Pirani paper that described the thought experiment not as mass connected by a spring, that is the bars which Weber was talking about, but a spatially separated mass whose separation could be monitored by measuring round trip time of light signals that travel between them. That is, one is talking about laser interferometers. He also made a first detailed noise sensitivity analysis of the situation and came to the conclusion that even if you had a very sensitive instrument, you have to estimate all the sources of noise which the interferometer will be subject to. And he made quantitative estimates of the shot noise, radiation pressure, thermal noise, seismic noise, gravity gradient noise, and so on. And therefore was in a position to really design an experiment which could detect gravitational waves. This came as to be known as the Blue Book in this particular community and eventually led to the 1989 proposal for the construction of LIGO. This is as far as the detector was concerned, but then there was a paradigm change in terms of the sources which we were looking for. And this happened in the years 1977 to 1978. Till that time, it was sort of believed that compared to supernova, gravitation, the coalescing compact binaries were less important kind of sources, as mentioned in this paper by Clark and Early. But then this whole calculation depended on what was the probability of disrupting a binary system. And very soon, Clark, Vandenhuyvel, and Sutaino realized that this was being wrongly estimated. And once you corrected that, the results really changed drastically. So in the 1978 Battelle conference, there is a statement which said, current results indicate that compact binary objects may well be the most promising sources of gravitational waves rather than supernova collapses. So you can see that the paradigm change which I was talking about happened because of technology. So from bar detectors, we went to laser interferometers. And in terms of astrophysics, from supernova, we went on to coalescing compact binaries. So putting together the astrophysics, which is the coalescing compact binaries and the quadrupole formula, one comes to the conclusion that a simple calculation will show you that a system like the binary pulsar 1913 plus 16 will coalesce in about 300 million years. So it implies that in the universe, which lasts for few billion, 13 billion years, there should exist in spiraling binary neutron stars which emit gravitational waves for hundreds of millions of years before coalescing spectacularly. And again, we were lucky because when they coalesce in the sensitivity bandwidth where you can build detectors. So the terrestrial laser interferometer detectors are sensitive in typically about 10 hertz to about a kilohertz or 10 kilohertz. And the frequency of these particular neutron stars when they are about to merge falls exactly in this particular bandwidth. And this also basically happens just because of the masses of these particular objects and the sizes of these particular objects. So you can see that we have to be lucky on all fronts to really get to where we finally got. So we come to the insight that the late in spiral and the merger epochs of compact binaries of neutron stars or black holes provide us possible strong sources of gravitational waves for detectors like LIGO and Virgo in the sensitivity bandwidth of about 10 hertz to about 10 kilohertz. Just by applying simple Kepler's law, when the body in spirals, it comes closer and therefore its frequency will increase with respect to time. And because it's in a stronger gravitational field, the amplitude increases with respect to time. And because the neutron stars are very, very small radii, unlike ordinary stars, which would start touching much earlier, you can come very, very close to each other, which is what makes the frequency in the bandwidth which we are talking about. Now, when it finally comes very, very close, you come to a situation which we call the the last stable circular orbit. And in this innermost stable circular orbit, the system will sort of plunge. And one can make an estimate just by simple analysis of the Schwarzschild solution that the frequency at this particular stage is given by this simple formula which is given here. So what it tells you is that depending on the mass of this particular object, either the late merger phase will fall within the bandwidth of the detector or outside it. Neutron stars essentially are toward the end. Black holes are at the more sensitive parts of the. And this, as you know, is why we saw our first detection is coalescing binary black holes rather than neutron stars, which happened also in a couple of years. The important point is that when it's about to merge, the system is highly relativistic. So the famous quadrupole formula by which Hulse and Taylor got their Nobel Prize is not adequate in this particular case. Now, qualitatively, we are in good shape, but let's quantitatively estimate what is the strain on a detector if a binary system like the binary pulsar is in the nearest cluster of galaxies, which is the Virgo cluster of galaxies. It turns out that when you use that simple quadrupole formula, the strain is of the order of 10 raised to minus 21 and not 10 raised to minus 39 for a laboratory kind of source. So if you can build an interferometer, which is a kilometer scale of a kilometer scale, you need to measure a displacement of about 10 raised to minus 18 meter. And therefore, the detection of gravitational waves really requires you to measure a very, very small strain or a minuscule displacement, 1,000th of a Fermi, smaller than the nuclear dimension, to detect gravitational waves. To understand the challenge, recall that the Michelson-Morley experiment of special relativity measured a displacement of about 10 raised to minus 9 meters. So you can see that you really needed to cover 10 orders of magnitude, and it's no surprise that it took 100 years to come to have the technology to make the detection of gravitational waves. So now, having said that we can detect gravitational waves, we try to understand what are the sources, what are the challenges when we want to model these particular sources. And then you sort of realize that even gravitational waves from these very strongly gravitating bodies like neutron stars and black holes are weak signals because they are buried in the large noise of the detector. So in the output of the detector, you can't directly see a signature of these weak signals. So you really have to use an engineering technique like match filtering, both to detect or extract the signal, and then later on to estimate its parameters or characterize this particular signal. So to do match filtering, what you really do is correlate the noisy data which you get from your detector with a signal which you know, because in this particular case, we are looking for a signal from a coalescing binary, which we know is a chirp signal. So what is shown here in this particular cartoon is the gravitational wave noisy data in which is buried a deterministic coalescing binary set of signal. So if you do a correlation, wherever you do, there is no signal, the correlation is sort of very, very small. But when you match exactly at this particular point with this particular signal, there is a sharp correlation which is picked up. So even though the signal is drowned in the noise, the correlation is very distinctly seen if you know how the signal exactly looks like. Because remember, the correlation really depends on the matching of phase which you can do here. And therefore, this immediately tells you that if you want to succeed in match filtering, you really need to model the signal very, very accurately using the best theory of gravity which you have, which is the general theory of relativity. There is another challenge, basically, because of the fact that the signal really will depend on the parameters of the astrophysical object, on its masses, on its spin, and etc. So therefore, you can't just work with one template. You really have to construct a very large template bank which will cover all the parameters which this system can sort of depend on. And this is the data analysis challenge, which essentially was the challenge which was really followed by Sanjeev Durandar, my distinguished colleague at IUCA, and his group. So they really contributed to the construction of these template banks, which are used to construct and look for gravitational waves. Now, what really happened is the fact that you are looking at systems that, as I said, are very, very relativistic. And therefore, when the project was about to be sort of funded, at that particular time, it was sort of realized that the theoretical problems also need to be addressed on the same time scale. This work was really initiated by Kip Thorne at Caltech, who for a couple of years had a very large team of people looking into this particular problem. And at the end of their analysis, they came up with a very famous physical review letter, which is called The Last 3 Minutes, Issues in Gravitational Wave Measurements of Coalescing Compact Binaries. You sort of realized, what he realized was that you really are talking about a system which initially inspirals, then merges. And once it sort of merges, it is like a bell, which is sort of dying. And therefore, you have what we call today as the ring down or the quasi-normal mode of this collapsed kind of object. But if you, even if you could analytically model the inspiral phase, you really need numerical relativity to look at the merger phase. And therefore, he convinced the National Science Foundation to initiate a grand challenge program in numerical relativity outside of LIGO to look for the merger gravitational waves from coalescing compact binaries. He also wanted to turn the attention of the full community in general relativity to this important problem. So in 1993, he organized a meeting at Caltech, inviting many researchers, among them Luc Blanchet, Sanjeev Durandar, and myself. And at this particular meeting, the challenge which was really posed in modeling these waves was sort of voiced. And I again repeat to you that the challenge really happens when you do analytical calculation, basically because of the fact that when you're looking at self-gravitating systems, then you have to, you know, take into account the non-linearities of Einstein's equations. You have to go beyond linearized gravity. Now, whenever you have a very hard problem, instead of just getting stuck in the mathematics, it's good to think physically. So the kind of physical inputs which we really used are the fact that if you really look at the inspiraling compact binaries, by the time they are about to merge, they would not be in eccentric orbits. And therefore, you could imagine that they move in quasi-circular orbits. As I explained to you, match filtering is sensitive to the phase. So instead of trying to do the full hard problem, let us try to get into control the phase information of the gravitational waves. And this is what was done and what is today called as the restricted waveform, which we begin with to do data analysis. Then you sort of physically argue that there are two timescales in the problem. One is an inspiral, which is given because of radiation reaction, and another is the orbital timescale. So you can work in an adiabatic approximation and assume that instead of going on an inspiraling orbit, the binary goes from one circular orbit to another circular orbit. Now, what this allows you to do is allows you to technically separate out the effects of radiation reaction from the conservative effects. And the conservative effects are much more difficult to deal with. And you could indirectly work with the radiation reaction effects by calculating the fluxes of the gravitational waves emitted by this particular system. Also, our physical systems are not ordinary stars. They are neutron stars and black holes. And since they are very, very small, they are very, very compact, you can forget the tidal interactions. So in the first approximation, we can model our black holes and neutron stars as point particles, and they may be represented by delta functions, which makes the calculation easier to do. So essentially, you really have to work with three steps in the adiabatic approximations. You calculate the motion of this particular system. Given a binary system, you iterate Einstein's equations and calculate the conservative motion of this particular system. So you can compute the conserved energy and angular momentum. Then you compute the generation of gravitational waves. On a fixed orbit, because the quadrupole moment and other moments are changing, there should be radiation. So you compute the multiples of the gravitational field and then compute the far zone flux of energy and angular momentum. And then you say that because it's losing energy and angular momentum, as Chandrasekhar said, there should be a radiation reaction. And therefore, using that radiation reaction part, you can calculate how the frequency changes with respect to time and how the phase changes with respect to time. And this essentially is the starting point of what was sort of pointed out in this famous paper, which I sort of mentioned to you, that if you know the conserved energy at the Newtonian order, the quadrupole formula, you can calculate how the phase changes with respect to time. And when you do that, you sort of realize that the quadrupole formula is very, very inadequate. You really have to go at least to the order V5 by C5, if you really want to not lose a phase information. And therefore, what you really need to do is go beyond the Newtonian calculation by calculating the flux to higher orders of accuracy, the energy to higher orders of accuracy. And if you do this calculation, equivalently, what you're able to do is correct Newton's acceleration by terms which are accurate up to the sixth post-Newtonian order. And what is sort of shown here in colors are the terms which are not directly calculated. They are calculated by this balance argument, which I sort of told you about. So what this allows you to do is allows you to correct the inspiral or the radiation reaction by going very, very far, you know, three orders of magnitude beyond the leading term. So this is the leading term which was sort of verified by the binary pulsar. But if you really want to model a source for LIGO, you really need to go much, much higher. So what this really told you is that you really needed to model these gravitational waves much more accurately than you knew sort of before. So the techniques which you really use are generalizations of techniques which we use in electromagnetism. For example, in electromagnetism also, the multiple expansion plays a very convenient kind of role because it allows you to model arbitrary kind of sources. So we use multiple expansions, but instead of working in terms of spherical harmonics or tensor spherical harmonics, we use the symmetric trace-free tensors, which are equivalent representations of these tensor spherical harmonics. Then, as I told you, you have to deal with the nonlinearities of the Einstein's equation. So you do what is called as a post-Minkowskian expansion. That means you assume that first you have flat space-time, and then you correct the flat space-time equations by orders in G, G square, G cube, etc. And like you do in quantum mechanics when you do perturbation theory, when you do these kind of perturbation calculations to the source, the next order wave function or metric is given by the corrections which happens at the previous order. So one can set up a hierarchy of Einstein, of equations using which this calculation basically can be done. And then after you do an expansion in terms of G, you want to match these kind of solutions to what happens at the source. And this cannot be done in the most general way. You can only do it in the near zone. So you do what is called as a post-Newtonian expansion or an expansion in V by C. When you're working with the test particle limit, there are other methods which are called perturbation theory methods, etc. And of course, when you want to deal with the merger, you have to do numerical relativity. So finally, therefore, as I said, at the end of the day, or at the end of about 15 to 20 years, you come up with what is the conserved energy of the system to the fourth, you know, to V8 by C8. What is the flux of gravitational waves at higher orders? So you can see that in this particular formula, in addition to the even terms, there are fractional powers of X, which means odd powers of V by C. These are interesting terms which come from the nonlinearities of Einstein's equations. Basically, when you have gravitational waves which you observe today, you have radiation which is not only emitted in the which travels on the light cone, which comes like this, but there can be radiation which was emitted in the past, which gets scattered by the static field of the gravitational of this object and then reaches us. These terms, which are coming because of this scattering, is called the tail term. The other thing is, which you have to worry about, is that whenever you have gravitational waves which are emitted, the gravitational waves itself has a time dependence and it can emit gravitational waves. This leads to terms which are called the nonlinear memory term. this appears at V5 by C5. And then you can have higher order scatterings. The radiation emitted in the past can be scattered not once, but by twice. So you have what is called as tail of tails. So that leads to another kind of complication. So you can see here that unlike the electromagnetic case, the calculation in this particular area to model the coalescing compact binaries involves a lot of technical complications. But the interesting thing is that the general theory of relativity allows you to compute this very, very explicitly. So putting all these things together, you have a formula that tells you what is the phase of the gravitational waves if you take into account all these kind of corrections. So you can see here that there are these kind of very large kind of numbers, very strange coefficients appearing in this particular formula. What you have to realize is that all these numbers which appear in this particular formulas are a reflection of the general theory of relativity, because the theory of gravity which you have used to compute this waveform is the general theory of relativity. So in a sense, these are like the signatures of the general theory of relativity coded in the gravitational waveform. Now, as I told you, when you are dealing with a system which is in spiraling, at some particular point, because the system is moving very, very relativistically, the analytical approximation essentially breaks down. So you really have to find some methods to extend your analytical calculation. And one of the methods which was sort of proposed is, instead of using the ordinary Taylor series, try to use resummation techniques like the Pardee resummation techniques to extend the domain of validity of the series which you sort of calculate. And later on, for example, another idea was proposed by Bonanno and Damour, who essentially said that one can extend the idea which one has in classical mechanics of using effective one-body techniques. If you remember, when you try to solve the two-body problem, you replace it by an idea of a total mass and an effective body of mass mu moving around a body of mass m. So the field theory version of it is what they call the effective one-body technique. And this essentially is a method which basically starts from the Hamiltonian for the two bodies, and then you replace it by an effective metric which codes in itself the information which is sort of buried in the post-Newtonian expansion. So this effective one-body technique is, in some sense, I can say, the field theory version of what we do in classical mechanics. You artificially create, by a constructive procedure, a metric. So instead of talking about the mechanics of two bodies, you can think of an effective body moving in the metric, an effective metric created by these two bodies. And the first success of this particular theory was the following. If you remember, Kip Thorne was always worried that this phase would be very, very complicated. When you apply the effective one body to the two body problem, what Bonanno and Damour could show was that there is not this very complicated phase. The in spiral almost smoothly, very quickly goes and joins to the ring down. And the reason it technically, physically happens is because by the time you get to this particular point, there are not many time scales. There's only one particular dynamical time scale in this particular problem. And therefore, you really see that the waveform very simply moves from the in spiral very quickly through the merger to the ring down. All this was really happening because the numerical relativity was not sort of succeeding. But in 2005, Pretorius made a remarkable breakthrough in numerical relativity. And he could, for the first time, calculate what happens in the final stages when two bodies really in spiral and merge. So this breakthrough allowed other relativist groups working in numerical relativity to fine-tune and tweak their methods. And very soon, many groups essentially could do numerical relativity with binary kind of systems, specifically black holes in the first instance and then neutron stars. But the important point you have to keep in mind is that these black hole simulations are very, very time-consuming. You cannot build template banks by using purely numerical simulations. And therefore, you like to use the information from numerical simulations fold it in into an analytical framework and then use it to do data analysis. For example, if you wanted to do the simulation of a particular binary black hole, which is called the 15-12-26 source, it takes about 3 months and takes about, and it took about 70,000 CPU hours. So you can see here that it is even today not very easy to go directly to build a template bank by using numerical relativity, though people think that eventually maybe we may be able to do it. So as I explained to you, we have this effective one body, which essentially tells you that the post-Newtonian waveform goes very quickly through what is predicted by numerical relativity, and then it rings down by what we can predict by using analytical perturbation theory. There was another way of dealing with this, which was sort of pioneered by our colleague Ajit. He basically pointed out that what we really do in an actual calculation is not use time domain waveforms. We go from time domain waveforms to the frequency domain waveform. So essentially, the data analysis is for the frequency domain waveform. For in-spiral is known very well. So what one was proposed is that by extending in frequencies, and you can try to construct a waveform analytically using insights from in-spiral and numerical relativity. And these are called the in-spiral merger ring down or IMR phenomenological waveforms. So this is another family of waveforms which we use to do our data analysis. So as I have tried to tell you, source modeling is a large community exercise. It begins with analytical, very simple analytical works. But then today it has become very, very sophisticated, because starting from the very simple thing which I explained to you, which can be done by different flavors of calculations, there are field theory methods to do the same calculation. And more recently, there are techniques in particle high energy physics and string theory, which can also be used to do some of these kind of calculations. I told you about the numerical relativity breakthrough, which gives you information which can be folded in effective one body and the IMR things to construct these particular waveforms. And these are some of the leaders. As I told you, you know, I have put pictures of some people who made the breakthroughs, but there are large teams of very, you know, talented young people who worked with them to construct the template banks by which we do our data analysis. So we were in a situation where the experiments were driving the theory. There is this remarkable theory, which is the general theory of relativity, which you can apply to coalescing compact binaries made of black holes and neutron stars. And this is what underlies the efficient, sophisticated data analysis infrastructure, which uses the state-of-the-art computing which we have available today. So you can see here that all this definitely was not possible a few years, let's say 20 or 30 years before. So today, we can detect these gravitational waves, estimate the parameters of these particular sources, and as I told you, try to see whether the prediction of gravity, general theory of relativity, is really the correct one as seen in the data. And for this, for detection, we construct these template banks, and many of the latter things are done by Bayesian methods, which are used very heavily, as you know, in high energy physics and other astronomy projects also. Now, I just want to sort of point out, how do you extract physics from the gravity wave observation? So for example, if you had a binary black hole, I've been pointing out its waveform for you. Its waveform essentially consists of in-spiral, a merger, and a ring down. And it folds in information, as I told you, about all the physical effects which come in general theory of relativity. And as I said, because it's a very, very compact object, a black hole, the signal almost is the signal of a point object, two point objects going around each other almost till the end. But what happens if you had two neutron stars going around each other? Neutron stars are not as stiff, not as compact as the black holes. So you would believe that at some particular point, when they come closer, there will be tidal effects of one body on the other. And because of these tidal effects, you will have deviations from the point particle waveform. That is what is shown in this particular figure, where in black are the point particles or the black hole waveforms, and in red are the neutron star waveforms for a particular equation of state. And therefore, you can see that this deviation has some information on the amount of tidal effects. And the amount of tidal effects is determined by the equation of state of this neutron star. So therefore, in the gravitational waveform is coded information of high of the equation of state of matter at very, very high densities. So the experiment drove the theory, and we went from initial LIGO over the 90s to the end of 2010 when initial LIGO finished. And in that same period, you know, the activities related to constructing the waveforms really sort of proceeded. And therefore, by the time we were in advanced LIGO and started to take the readings for that, by that particular time, we had the accurate enough source modeling to be able to detect these gravitational waves and to characterize them. This, just as this exercise keeps on going, for example, we just finished the third observational run, and after some commissioning, which may happen for about a year, we will move on to the fourth observation run, where the sensitivity will be even more. Similarly, the source modeling also keeps on improving. So from the 3PN, which is the state of the art now, people are now trying to get control of the 4PN and even higher orders of source modeling. So let me just end by sort of saying, what did all this achieve? And what I'm going to say in the next few slides is the achievement of a very large collaboration, the LIGO scientific collaboration and the Virgo collaboration. And the idea to really bring it together was the brainchild of the high energy physicist Barry Barish. So as I sort of told you, what you really saw was that as soon as the advanced LIGO detectors were turned on, almost we were just about to begin our runs, and immediately in the detectors at Hanford, Washington, and Livingston, Louisiana, we saw what was like a signal. And remember, if they are signals, then they should be similar, and therefore they should appear with some slight time delay. So you can see that by shifting one signal relative to the other, you can see that they are probably representing similar kind of, they are signals from the same astrophysical kind of source. Because of the fact that we know how these waveforms are, we can infer using this particular data what the parameters of the signals are. And using numerical relativity, we can reconstruct what these expected signals are. That is what is shown on the next two panels. And then if you subtract one from the other, you should be left with essentially residuals which have to be consistent with the noise. So what is shown here in the two panels below are the time frequency plots that suddenly in both the detectors you see something which shoots up, and that is what we are identifying as a black hole kind of signal. Once you have a signal of that particular kind, what we really have to do is that what is shown in blue is a waveform which a detector sees. What is shown in yellow is our model, depending on the parameters of the particular signal. So what you basically start doing is start changing the parameters of this particular signal, and then try to see eventually what is the data consistent with. And roughly, this is what you really have to do by doing parameter estimation by Bayesian methods. And that essentially gives you the parameters of this particular source. And that is what is given in this particular slide, which is shown here. So you can see here that we characterize, we not only detect this particular signal, we see the parameters, we extract out the parameters of the signal, and immediately we sort of realize that we are seeing a new class of objects. Nobody had seen black holes so massive before, and therefore we are seeing a black hole source, which is at a quite a large distance, and because of the fact that it's a massive source, even though it is further away, we can see it in our detector. The fact that modeling plays an important role in the discovery was recognized when in 2016, the breakthrough prize was given to the LIGO-Virgo collaboration. But in addition to the people in the LIGO-Virgo collaboration, a few people who contributed to analytical modeling and numerical relativity also are part of this. And that really tells you the critical role which modeling has played in the discovery of this of gravitational waves. And as you know, in 2017, the Nobel Prize was awarded to Ray Wise, Kip Thorne, and Barry Barish. Half the prize, it's of course a remarkable experimental achievement. So half the prize went to Rainer Wise. Kip Thorne was involved in the modeling. And as I said, converting, putting together the scientific management structure to do this challenging project was the insight of Barry Barish. A couple of years after that, the gravitational wave from the first neutron star binary was also sort of seen. And as you can see here in this particular figure, this signal is lasting for a long time. There are about 4,200 cycles in this particular bandwidth, and the signal lasts for about 100 seconds, a very large signal to noise ratio. So the important point is, even though it's a less massive kind of source, because you can build the signal over 100 seconds, the signal to noise ratio can be built up and it becomes very high. So knowing the phase very, very accurately plays a very, very important role in the analysis of binary neutron stars. And of course, playing the same game, we can calculate all the parameters of this particular source. And in addition to all the other parameters, one could estimate the tidal deformability parameter and therefore use the value of the tidal parameter to say something about whether there are some equations of state of neutron stars which can be ruled away by these gravity wave observations. As I told you, the coefficients which appear in our formula are signatures of the general theory of relativity. So using them, you can test the general theory of relativity. And such a thing was done both by the binary neutron star case, where in which particular case, in addition to gravitational waves, electromagnetic radiation was also sort of received. So by putting together information from electromagnetism and gravitational waves, one can put a limit on the difference in speed of the gravitational waves and of light. I won't go through the list which is sort of given here, but I just want to sort of point out that many tests of basic physics, astrophysics, and so on can be done by using the information which you have from source modeling of these particular objects. You can do similar tests by using the black hole observations. And again, these have also been sort of done and continue to be done as the O3 observations are sort of continuing and data is being sort of analyzed. So you can see here that the source modeling plays a very critical role in the detection, in reconstructing the source, and already now in testing general theory of relativity in the dynamic strong field domain. So with this, I come to my concluding remarks. We can say that with advanced LIGO, we have achieved the technology to make a direct detection of gravitational waves 100 years after Einstein predicted them. And I hope you sort of realize that the 100 years were really required on all fronts. We also have the required progress in the two-body problem in general relativity and the related data analysis to detect gravitational waves, characterize them, and begin to test general relativity in the dynamic strong field regime. At its centenary, the GR has not only passed many stringent tests in flying colors, but has consolidated to become an essential tool for describing the universe on manifold scales, from satellites and planets to black holes and the Big Bang. It is the experiment which has been driving the theory. The experimental challenge to detect gravitational waves and explore multi-messenger astronomy and astrophysics has led to a remarkable progress in the theoretical two-body problem in general theory of relativity. the classic two-body problem in general relativity, pushed by the requirements of an unforgiving technology-driven fundamental physics experiment, has rejuvenated itself to meet the challenges. Remember, there was a babble for about 50 years, but gradually through the binary pulsar and now through the binary black hole observations, general relativity has reinvented itself. So therefore, analytical relativity is still a crucial and vibrant research area for experiments that will revolutionize our understanding of the universe. We are all living in a very remarkable era because, as you heard in Kimbavi's talk, the eclipse experiment in 1919 essentially made Einstein an icon of humanity and its, you know, achievement. We are happy that, you know, we were fortunate that on February 11, 2016, when the announcement of gravitational waves from binary black holes came about, this news really was over all the newspapers over the world. So in a sense, we were reliving what happened in 1919. So obviously, you know, Einstein should really be smiling, because what more would he want at the centenary of GR and gravitational waves? So let me end my talk by acknowledging my collaborators over the last 20 years in modeling gravitational waves. And thank you for your attention.
Hello, Professor Iyer. This is Sameer Durde from IUCA, and I'm here to help by reading out the audience questions to you.
Okay, thank you.
So first of all, thanks for the lucid talk on this technical topic. I will read out some questions which would increase in order of, I think, complications as your talk progressed. So we could start with the people asking about how did Le Verrier find that Mercury is precessing?
Okay, so, you know, when you look at the... people, you know, studying the orbits, essentially, you know, mark its orbit over many, as you can see, you know, the observations are made over many, many years. So essentially, you sort of make an observation of this particular planet over a long time, and then you sort of see that the planet essentially is making an elliptical orbit, and the you can sort of say, you know, what is the closest approach of this particular planet. So essentially, you are reconstructing this particular orbit and sort of seeing when is the closest approach to the sun, that is the perihelion. And then, does this perihelion remain at the same point after 100 years? So remember, this small amount of precision which you see is over 100 years. So it's a very, very painstaking kind of observation, and really speaks of the remarkable confidence that the astronomers had about their observations of these planetary things which they were sort of making.
Right. So with the orbital decay, there's also the Hulse-Taylor binary pulsar. So Maitreya Kundu asks that how was this orbital decay measured?
So again, as I said, you know, in this particular case, the trick, as I said, is the fact that you are doing something which you do in radio astronomy called pulsar timing. So you essentially have to see the fact that if this was just a pulsar, it would have a very periodic kind of motion. But then this periodic motion is getting modulated because of all the effects, because it's in a binary system. So there are going to be Doppler effects, relativistic Doppler effect. Then there is going to be a redshift effect, higher order redshift effect. So what you really have to do is try to do this, you know, construct a model, putting in all these particular parameters, and then putting all these particular parameters, you know, you reconstruct that what is the value of the parameters which gives you the pulsars, the pulsar profile which you are sort of expecting to sort of get. So it is really folding in the astronomy, the timing information, and a model of this particular orbit, modeling in the Newtonian, the leading Newtonian effects and the general relativistic effects, and then extracting out from this model the values of these various parameters, and including, you know, what is, so these various physical effects are sort of measured, and the accuracy with which you can measure these particular effects essentially tells you what are the masses of this particular system. So you really have to have a consistent value of the two masses so that all the observations are consistent with each other. And this is how you both extract out the, do these tests and extract out the parameters of this binary system.
A basic question has come from Neil Vadodaria, asking what is meant by self-gravitating systems?
So what do we mean by self-gravitating system, you know, is the fact that when you have two bodies moving around each other, what is causing their motion is the mutual gravity between them. So self-gravitating system means that a system which has gravity and the motion which you're talking about is also happening because of the gravitational field. It is not that you have some electrostatic force or electromagnetic force which is causing the motion and you are calculating something else like that. So for example, if I have a scale, the scale is not held by gravitational forces. It's held by atomic sort of molecular forces or atomic forces or so or something like that, right? And then therefore, if I take this scale and make it fall in a fall the field of the earth, the motion is being affected by the gravitational field, but the body itself is not, you know, the relevant thing is not the gravitational force of the particular gravitational self-attraction of this particular body. So a problem in which everything, the only operating thing is the gravitational. For example, we're not taking into account other forces which may be there because it's radiating and so on and so on. So what one is taking into account is only the gravity in this particular system and the effect of that particular gravity on its motion and its radiation.
Thank you. There's also a question about the quadruple nature of gravitational waves. So people want to know how, why are gravitational waves quadruple in nature, and what is their significance in this field?
Okay. That's a good question. I didn't sort of emphasize this. So let's go back to something which you know, for example, in electromagnetism. So when you learn electromagnetism, you talk about the radiation formula and you say that the formula is given by a dipole formula. So you should have asked the question at that particular time, why is there no monopole radiation of electromagnetism? And then when you think about this, you can sort of very easily convince yourself that if you needed monopole radiation of electromagnetism, it will depend on the time derivative of the charge. But charge is conserved. So therefore, the fact that charge is conserved is why there is no monopole radiation. And the leading order radiation is quadruple, is dipole in electromagnetism. A similar thing, when you try to analyze the gravity case, what one realizes is that gravity, unlike electromagnetism, is described by what we call as a spin-to field. So in addition to conservation, and there are conservation laws associated with that. And the conservation laws are the familiar conservation laws which we know, conservation law of energy, linear momentum and angular momentum. And therefore, unlike the case of electromagnetism, in addition to not having the monopole radiation, we also don't have the possibility of dipole radiation. So the leading order radiation in gravity is the quadrupole radiation. So if a system does not have a time-varying quadrupole moment, then you will not have gravitational radiation.
Great. So there's a question about why, sorry, if we use a gravitational wave from a single source in a double slit experiment, would we get an interference pattern on a screen, say? This is by Rahul's
Yeah. Remember that whenever, you know, one thinks of these particular questions, what is very important is to keep in mind the values of the quantities which are sort of involved. So for example, you know, when you're talking about the standard double slit experiment, what is relevant is the double slit and the wavelength of electromagnetic waves. Now, if you try to ask the same question about the gravitational waves I'm talking about, what is their wavelength? You would very easily sort of see that the wavelength of these gravitational waves is of the order of few thousands of kilometers. So in the standard sense in which you talk about interference, you would not really be talking about these kinds of effects. So in a sense, one has to see other manifestations of the wave nature of gravitational waves and not some things like this. For example, you know, just like you have lensing effects in astronomy of electromagnetic waves, people are talking about the effect due of gravitational waves getting lensed. Now, in signatures of the gravitational wave lensing, in the first instance, you know, you don't see signatures of the wave nature of gravitational waves. But then people now are sort of saying that beyond the leading order understanding, can one see in such situations reflections or signatures of the wave nature of gravitational waves? And such kind of research is happening at present when people try to see, you know, what all things you can do with gravitational waves, which you could do earlier with only electromagnetic waves.
Thanks. So another question is about numerical relativity, which is your specialization. So in numerical relativity, how do you represent the singularities or infinities as computer codes?
So, you know, as you would sort of realize, we don't, the singularities are causes of our problem. So the whole strategy is to work around them. So different numerical schemes try to do it by different ways. One of the schemes, for example, is by excising that from the numerical domain. And this is what, for example, one set of colleagues who work in numerical relativity do. So there are, the problem is that because of these singularities, when you try to implement a numerical solution of Einstein's equations, you really have to, you know, technically deal with them and try to elevate the effects which these singularities could have on your evolution of your space times. So, you know, I myself am not a specialist in it. But for example, there are different groups. For example, the most successful group is what is called the SX group, which uses spectral techniques to solve Einstein's equations. So most of the times you will sort of find that one is finding ways to bypass this particular problem and not really model it in this particular problem.
Okay. So a question is there from Yuvraj, and he asks, where do we get the models of a signature, and so that we can correlate with the new data?
Yes. So the main point, as I said, is that we are our very prototype kind of sources, which we expected to see, are these very nice systems coalescing compact binaries made up of binary neutron stars and black holes. And as I explained to you in my talk, if you can use Einstein's general theory of relativity, cast it in a form so that you can predict what the waveform will look like very, very accurately. It is this information about how the waveform would look like if the bodies have certain masses and certain spins, which is the starting point for doing everything which I told you in my particular talk. So the key is the modeling, which comes by using general theory of relativity to model these particular objects as accurately as possible by folding in as much physics as required. For example, as I explained to you, when you look at neutron stars, they are situations where matter is at play. So you really have to take into account all the matter effects, and therefore modeling the gravitational wave from a binary neutron star is far more complicated than gravitational waves from two black holes. The other important point is we do expect to see gravitational waves from sources like supernova. But the supernova process is so complicated physically that we really don't know what exactly the waveform would look like. So when we try to look for supernova or sources which cannot be sort of modeled, we cannot use the mass filtering techniques, which I explained in my particular talk. You use other techniques which are called burst techniques, where you just try to see whether in the time frequency plane there are a set of pixels which light up, and whether they light up consistently in different detectors. So depending on the kind of sources you are looking for, you really have to tune in your search techniques for doing that. And I just focus on what we look for most of the time, but there are other sources of gravitational waves, like from supernova, from isolated pulsars, from stochastic background of sources, for which other techniques are basically used.
Thanks. A related question is that why do we need to have data analysis for every merger that we detect? Isn't there any method or software which can just do that on the run and detect all mergers with all the fields included?
Okay, the point is that, as I try to sort of explain, we really don't know the parameters of this particular source. We don't know where this source, how far the source is, where does this source is on the sky, how is its orbit oriented relative to our detector. So when you try to make a count of all these particular parameters, it is about a 15 parameter set. So even for a single source, depending on the parameters with these 15, if you change these 15 parameters, the effect on your detector, the strain on your detector will sort of change. So that is the reason whenever we detect a particular source, after we are sure that we have detected it, we really do a Bayesian parameter reconstruction of this particular source. And therefore, you will see that whenever we quote some numbers, we always say that with 90% confidence, our parameters are this. So it is the fact that we really don't know all these particular parameters that essentially makes it difficult to have just a simple way of extracting what these things are.
A query is that can gravitational waves from two different sources interfere, and could that cause a problem at any stage in the observations?
Yes. So at this particular point, as you have heard in the talks by Sanjeet, Suresh, and so on, at this particular point, our detectors are sensitive and they can see up to a certain distance in the universe, and therefore they scan a certain volume of the universe. as they become more sensitive, they would see more and more volumes. And as they remain online for longer times, the time volume will also sort of increase. So the number of sources you see would definitely start sort of increasing. At this particular point, we are in a domain where we really don't see a signal, let's say, every few minutes or something like that. We basically see a signal every week. But definitely, as we keep going to more sensitive detectors, we would really be in a situation that it would be a challenge to to be able to sort of separate one signal from the other. But as I said, that what would probably happen is that our sensitivity, our detection techniques would also become more sensitive. So what may really happen is, as happens sometimes in when you study nuclear physics, is that you sort of do it sort of systematically. You try to fit in the first source and subtract it out, and then in the subtracted data, see whether there is a signature of some other source and so on. So what you say will definitely be a challenge for data analysis. But the point is, you know, will they sort of interfere, right? So the whole question, again, one has to keep in mind that whenever you talk about the gravitational interaction, overall, the gravitational interaction is 10 raised to 39 times weaker compared to the electromagnetic interaction. So essentially, even if two gravitational waves from two different sources are coming at each other, their interaction is not going to be strong enough to really make one affect the other. So it will be a data analysis challenge, not necessarily something which will make the two signals interfere. That is what I would say.
Excellent. Audience person is asking that how do we get to know about the masses of the compact objects which merge, and how do we find the resultant mass in your calculations?
So as I said, the what we really do is, as I said, we have constructed this template bank, and using this template bank, we try to initiate our detection process. So when we initiate this detection process, the match filter, which matches this particular signal, essentially gives us a rough value of what this particular parameter should be. It turns out that a combination of these particular masses called the chirp mass is what can be what dominantly decides the shape of this particular waveform. So from this combination, we can sort of say that the following combinations of two masses will lead to this particular chirp mass. So there is a table which we have. Then, as I said, you do the parameter estimation exercise. And the parameter estimation exercise essentially tells you with 90% confidence what your masses should be. Now, once you know what those masses are, you can run a numerical relativity code. And that numerical relativity code will finally tell you what the system will finally merge into. So that will tell you what the final mass of this particular system is. So as I said, you know, you start from detecting, then do the parameter estimation, go back to your theory, use insights from that particular theory to do the... And because we have done many numerical runs, there are empirical formulas which tell you, given the initial masses and the initial spins, what the final masses and spins should be. So all the information which is sort of earlier extracted from doing numerical relativity of many, many systems is sort of culled into an analytical formula which tells us, given a particular initial mass, what the final mass should be. And also, as I said, we can check it by doing the numerical relativity kind of simulation. So you try to do the calculations in many different ways and make sure that you get consistent results by the different analysis which you do. And this is what sometimes, you know, makes the analysis take so much time. You know, the analysis is done, but our papers take a few months to write, basically because all this process involves a lot of computing and a lot of cross checks and so on.
Thanks. We'll come to the last few questions. We are going to set up a detector in India, the LIGO India project. And so there's a question asking, what is the basis of the decision of the location? So do we use any GR, etc. for that?
In principle, one would have liked to do such a scientific exercise. But as you know, the practical considerations of finding two long, airport strips and not disturb the local population in a densely populated state like India, essentially really, came to that particular site. So I would say that we did look for sites all through the country, and we realized that scientifically, the fact that the Deccan Plateau is seismically stable meant that many regions were seismically good sites in India. Then the practical considerations of, is there a railway line going through the close to this particular site? Is there an airport close by? Is there some industry close by? When you start folding in every one of these noise sources created by human beings and human activity, then at the end of the day, you sort of realize that there's very little leeway you have. So finally, after doing all this particular exercise, we were fortunate that at Hingoli, we had a site which not only fulfilled our scientific requirements, but also was sort of possible to acquire with the support of the government and all the activities which went on at Iuka. So it is practical considerations and not really, which site in India would give you the best scientific return. Typically, we have done that particular exercise and have sort of found that the difference is not more than 5 to 10%.
That's interesting. We'll come to the last question. This is a very simple question. Asking why is everything in the universe spinning, right, from electron to black holes and galaxies?
So the question is, if you really wanted it to be non-spinning, that's a strange situation, right? So the whole point is that when you have things sort of moving about, you essentially will have not only energy, but it will have sort of angular momentum. So when you try to make objects of any kind, coming to something which is not spinning is sort of more artificial than having things sort of spinning. And that is what we see all in almost all the observations which we do. It's basically because of the fact that to really get to some static stage, you need to fine-tune things. Whereas arbitrarily, if you take a set of parameters and then try to evolve that particular system, very likely it is going to have some random value of energy and angular momentum and linear momentum, I guess. That would be my naive answer.
Lovely. So we do not have everything perfect in nature that way. So thank you, Professor, for this talk. If you have any few words to end this, over to you.
Thank you. So thank you all for joining in this activity. Thank you for all the nice questions. Some of these questions I would have answered at the level at which I understand them. It doesn't mean that's the final answer. As Einstein said, the important thing is to keep questioning, and keep questioning not just in science, but in everything which happens around you, especially in these troubled times. So take care.